I've been working on a new way of working with Linux in my environment for the last couple of months now. And it's based on a very minimal footprint and very flexible to use. But it's not for the faint of heart. It requires the old style scripting and editing configuration files rather than running commands like se-manage and stuff like that. And basically it consists of the se-clc compiler, set files, load policy, and then the se tools. I would recommend them very much. And that's basically about it, I think. And I actually created packages for all that stuff. Get them on my GitHub. You can get them all on my GitHub pages. So here's the policy with the RPM spec file. Here's the compiler RPM spec file. It has the information inside that to get the latest, or at least get the latest supported se-clc compiler from the source. Then these are not related. And then here's policy coroutines. Basically, a trimmed down policy coroutines that will install only a couple of commands. Set files and load policies and se status and se con aren't really needed. I installed them, but those aren't, I could remove them as well. And I probably would advise to remove se status because it's not as small as the other three utilities. So, and that's all you need. So these two utilities and then se-clc and then the policy that I've written in the seal language, which is a really nice and flexible language, really powerful compared to the old reference policy. And even compared to writing policy in raw policy language, because really allows you to do nice stuff like associating attributes with attributes and really fancy stuff there. Anyway, so my policy is now in a initial state where it's quote usable unquote. I wouldn't actually recommend it in a production environment, but on my virtual machine it's actually in a state where I can do the basics, and so this would be a nice point to demo it. But I need to actually build package and install the latest updated package on the guest. So let me go to the monogam repository and then the latest commit. 264 commits. So if you look all the way down in the tree, then you'll see that I started from scratch, basically with very little, and this just started to work my way up. And after 2 months, this is where I am right now. So let me update the spec file with the latest commit. And we are actually in version 80, so it's kind of a big version. And I would basically, I'll call this fix as you log in. That's basically the last thing I did, almost. So, but yeah, a lot of work went into shutting it down. Another shut down, everywhere shut down. It's really like for those 5 seconds it takes to shut down your system. It required me about a week or 3 days to deal with it. It's so hard. Writing Linux policy is easy if Linux logs. If Linux doesn't log, then all hell breaks loose. Fix Linux login. And that happens, as Linux does in many cases, not log, for some stupid reason that I think should really be fixed. Anyway, so here's my terminal. At the top is a local terminal. This is my guest console, and this is my guest SSH, and these are other things, and this is my record my desktop thingy. So I need to actually get status here. I think I'm up to date. Yep. So I'll go to the spec file repository. Monogam spec, and just push that up. Yeah, and I'll go to my RPM build directory, RPM build sources, and retrieve the latest tarball. And then I'll replace the commit. And get that, and then edit the spec file that I'm using to build with the latest version. Specs mono again spec, edit that. Yeah, and then paste this in. This is the latest. And then use that to build. Should be somewhere in my history. Hopefully not too far back. Here it is. And now it's building an up-to-date policy package. It's actually policy and kind of some user space in one go. Then I can basically SFTP the policy package to my remote system. And I also have that in the history somewhere. Yeah. And then put that, quit that, and go to my virtual machine here. And there's a gotcha. Currently, I don't have RPM worked yet. RPM has some ASI Linux awareness in there, and it actually has it to the point where it breaks when ASI Linux is not exactly what RPM expected. It sucks big time. And that means actually that you can't install packages in enforcing mode, because then the post-installation scriptlets will fail, because some identifiers that RPM wants to use don't exist, or some rules don't exist, and then RPM doesn't know that before it installs a package, and so the post installation scriptlets will then fail to install and to do the thing, and all hell breaks loose. Anyways, so we'll just set it for 0. Oh, and actually I need to be root to shell. Set it for 0. And then install the package. I have a bunch of packages here, RPM, UVH, and I want the latest. Oh, damn. Forgot the R. It's RPM, not PM. And it'll install. And you can see later on that I also need to add some rules to, or I could add some rules to our RPM domain, because if I do assert mabcts recent, then you see that the RPM is denied some access. It's denied to actually install the policy and relabel to the policy. And that's basically some protection so that policy can be tampered with. the only thing that can do this is my is SECLC. SECLC is the only application that can actually write policy to the policy store file, to the policy store, so to speak, and that can actually write file contacts. And I think fixed files can relabel to policy config, so fixed files can actually do the relabeling. But other than that, nothing can, not even I can. But I don't do that manually. I always use my script. I have a script, it's enclosed with the policy. Let me have a look here. It's in the support directory. It's a simple script, load policy bash. It's getting installed into a user sbin load policy. And this basically, what it basically does is it compiles a policy in place, in the place, in etc as a Linux monogam, and then policy. And what it also does is it takes care of the file context. So it makes sure that the user home dir contexts are set up and stuff like that. So it's really simple, but it's a wraparound SECLC, and this can also be, this script can also be called from other scripts that might do specific things. Like for example, if you write a simple bash script that sets a boolean, that toggles a boolean in the policy, so persistent, then you can actually write a bash script that actually edits the policy module, the readable policy file in the store in etc as in Linux, and then just calls this script to rebuild the policy, the binary policy, with the change, with the boolean toggled on the fly. And you can do the same for ports. So if you want to add a port, you can write a simple bash script that basically adds a port to the source policy file and then compiles it again, and bang, you have a port. And so the nice thing is here that you can just use simple bash scripts, or you don't even have to use bash script. You can just go inside with your text editor and just edit it right from the source there, and then just run the script, and boom, it's applied. So that's that. So now actually, let's go back into enforcing mode again, because now we're in permissive mode. Get enforce, send enforce one, get enforce. So we have an updated policy. I could restore con. Oh, actually, I installed the policy, but the package doesn't actually load the policy. So I need to actually load the policy every time I install the policy. So this is actually in a forcing mode. So that should just work, and that works. This is old RPM stuff. So that's basically my script here, load policy, that'll basically update the policy using the updated source, which is located in LSL, etc, as in Linux, monogam, source. Here is basically all the source. You have the listing file, which lists all the modules. So you can basically, if you want to install a module, you can just basically add it to the listing, and then, well, in theory, add it to the listing, and then basically the SECLC will include it if it can. But SECLC is also confined, so you can't just create a SIL file in your home directory, add it to the listing, because SECLC will not be allowed to read it. So these are the entries here. And you see they're all located, the SIL files are all located in etc, SE Linux, monogam, source, policy, and under there. Because we know that SECLC can read them, and so that's all gravy. Anyway, so it's all there, all the modules are there. You can just straight up edit it, run the script, and the modification will be applied. You can add to it, add a file to the directory here, and add it to the listing, run the script, and boom, your policy will be added. Really simple, really nice, really clean. And you don't actually have to install the source. You can also just only ship the binary policy. If you have a a small appliance that doesn't have the resources to store all this stuff, then you can actually just ship the binary policy. You don't even have to ship the SSLC binary, because I have to say that's quite a big binary. If you do SELS LH user bin SSLC, and you see it's rather big. It's half a meg, so that's pretty big. But this is an all-in-one utility. If you have SSLC load policy and set files, then you're set, and then you can install SE Tools console, which is a really nice suite of utilities to do your querying. Like for example, SE Info. Here you have the policy statistics. So I have about 4,000 allow rules. I have about 500 types. I have 200 attributes. I have 86 non-audit rules. That's pretty much. I have 18 port cons, 3 type change, 1 raw allow, 4 type members, 0 permissives. And that's basically the current statistics of the policy. It's very minimal. It's just basically it's all I need for a very minimal Fedora 20. Minus cron, because cron also gets installed if you install a minimal Fedora, but I removed it because I don't like cron anymore. I'm using timers now. See, I'm not a systemd fanboy, but well, if I have it in the system, then I might as well use it. So I'm just doing that stuff mostly with timers, and like I said, I don't have to deal much with local users, just personal systems, so I don't have all the tough prerequisites. Anyway, so let's just, we're in enforcement mode, get enforce, and let's just shut down. Now this is something that might sound trivial to you, but it really isn't. This process of shutting down here, what you see, there's took me a hell of a lot of time to get it done. So now basically, this is basically a simple restart. And it looks pretty much clean. And you might think, oh, that is not such a big deal, but it actually is, because everything, almost everything is confined in the system. So let's look for our ABC denials again. There might be some, might not. Nope, there's none at all. But everything is actually confined, except for the user session, basically the shell session that I'm in, which is called session_t, which is unconfined. Which is pretty much unconfined, except that it can't manually write or create the policy files and relabel it manually, but it uses set files anyways, and I'm allowed to run set files with a domain transition, and the same for SSLC. I'm allowed to run SSLC with a domain transition, so I can do that, but only via those binaries, not directly. And other than that, I'm unconfined in the sense that I can't use the memprotect stuff. I can't use execmem. Let's have a look. SE search A, S, and then session T, and then process C process. See if I can find some things that I can do. So here you have a list of the stuff. I'll use ASCT. So I have 3 type transitions from to sill, to load policy, to set files. That's all. Then execmem, execheap, and ptrace is disallowed. Setcheck is allowed, but can be disallowed if you set secure mode insmod so that no one can insert modules. And then these are the process permissions that I have. And that's pretty pretty much everything, I suppose. Not sure. And capability is the same thing. I have been removing some stuff. So you are actually, or yeah, sys module, sys nice are disallowed. Well, other than that, you have sysadmin there. There's a lot of stuff in there, enough to get you going most of the time. But there's other protection there. For example, if I T file type, well, yeah, file type, then this is a lot. Then yeah, there's a lot of shit in here. I'm allowed to manage SSH in user home directories as well as slash root, because this domain is actually a root domain, so to speak, a privileged domain. So that's why I can basically maintain them all. Oh yeah, here you have the file stuff. So for example, what I can do is, a file isn't an entry point by default, and execmod is disallowed by default on all files. So there is some protection there. And I can probably write a shadow. I can do execmod, but only via a textrel shell, shardlibs. And then there's some name type transitions for SSH, both for admin home as well as for the normal user home. Let's insert shadow T. I think I can just manage it. Shadow T. File type. Yeah, I'm allowed to do pretty much everything. I did some stuff there. I did added some protection there. For example, let's have a look at proc types. There's some protection there as well, proc type. So basically, yeah, you can't see it, but that sucks by the way. Isn't there a way? So now it says, okay, you can read all the proc types, but you can't write to any proc types. But that's not exactly it. Let's see if this shows it. Nope, this doesn't show it either. It doesn't show it, but there's SEinfo X a proc type. And you see that there's various types. And for example, I could write to, for example, procnuma, I suppose. So let's have a look at procnuma to the T. And you see that I can actually see it doesn't list it in, if I search for just proc type. That sucks. It would be nice if SEinfo or SEsearch would see say, okay, he's looking for proc type attributes, and this attribute is part of the proc type attribute, so I need to list it here as well. So here you can see that it can actually write to all proc types except proc security and user mode helper. So I can actually write to NUMA. But if I actually look for proc security, then you see that I can't write to proc security. as an unconfined user. So I built that in. So yeah, it's unconfined, but it's not fully 100% unconfined. So as I said, the processes are all confined, and if you look at it, then as the info T, then you can see that I have a bunch of types there. Worth 500 types, and if I basically X domain, oops, X a domain, then you see that I have 84 domain types. Now there's zero permissive types, but there are a couple of unconfined types, which is the session type unconfined. Domain type, this is a attribute that I can use to list. My unconfined domains, because I know that. So there's two types, the session for the shell that I'm using, the root shell, so to speak, a root shell session, root shell or domain I would call it, and then there's the systemd daemon domain, and this is a domain for generic daemons. So for example, I haven't actually tested this, so it might probably fail, but if I, for example, install NTPD, so 740 and then yum install NTP, oh, 2 weeks old, install yum cron, no, I don't use that stuff. I don't use cron anymore. Okay, so set of four is one. See if there's AVC signals there. God damn it. And we have a AVC denial here. We have LVM trying to get attributes of an ETC file, LD so cache, and that file is mislabeled. So something restore the etc. I need to actually fix that, but ldconfig is not knowing transitions to it yet. So now it's fine. So this is an AVC denial there that is due to ldconfig, and I should fix that, but it's probably RPM running ldconfig or something like that. I'm not sure, of some RPM script. Anyway, so I installed NTP, so in theory, given for us. So in theory, I should just system control start NTPD. And that doesn't work. And this is so, yeah, this is one of those things, bugs everywhere. So systemd needs to actually do a couple of things for this to work. Actually, mount on temp, this is the temp namespace, private temp functionality that I don't yet support, but I need to actually support that. And it also needs to read proc VM overcommit. But yeah, that's something I should actually support. But let's just try it in permissive mode, send it 4.0, and I can also see what it needs. Okay, so center 4 is 1 now again. Now that should now be fine, I suppose. And here you have the stuff that it needs. And it's basically just mount on temp T and read proc VM. That's basically it, I suppose it. So I can actually just files mount on temp files. Actually add that. Where should I add it? This is a little bit of a mess. Oops. Files mount on temp, generic temp dirs. And then just temp t. Because that's what it does, that's what it is, isn't it? Generic temp dir, yeah. So, files mount on generic temp dirs, add that to systemd. Okay, files mount on generic temp dir. Call systemdt. And I'll make a comment for that, private temp. Okay, and then there's its proc over commit, and this is kernel, I suppose, and or system, I call it system. But I probably don't have an interface for that yet. Procfs, proc kernel, yeah, or actually I do proc. Don't, but I can make that pretty easy, I suppose. Proc VM and then list proc VM, or actually, is it proc or syscontrol? Yeah, right. VM, and then just add that you can see now, you can also see how simple it is to update systemd t. So basically what I can do now is this is what is it? Files. So I'll just add that system or kernel files. I just replace the file with what I have. Really manual, really simple. But this is a big file. It's one of the biggest. I should have freaking tested it first though, because there's always a typo. There's not a single modification without a typo, so let's just do that. Test it locally before I now there's another typo. Oops. So this one can be saved. Then we have systemd. Systemd. Sil. and actually that proc overcommit is probably ls rc proc sys vm. Yeah, shit, that's wrong. But it's in a VM, so I'll change that proc so that needs to be changed. See the builds. I don't should have thought about that, but so once again. Takes a little while. I need to find a way to do this in one go. Paste. And then system kernel itself. But yeah, there's just a lot of functionality that I haven't tested yet. So yeah, a lot of stuff that can go wrong. And that's why I'm saying it's not production ready. For me, it's no problem if something feels like this, I just fix it. So basically, just run load policy there and boom, it's committed. And now, let's just system get enforce, it's enforcing system control stop entity, and that seems to have worked. Echo exit status, but not sure if that actually works at exit status. So now let's try it again, start it in enforcing mode, see if it works now, and it seems to work. System control status entity, and it is running, although I do hear my disk code exited. Oh, it was actually. Oh, right. So, yeah, there's a couple of things to keep in mind here. Let's see if it's running. PSAUX grab NTPD. And as you can see, NTPD is running in enforcing mode. And it's running in the systemd daemon domain, which is basically a domain for unspecified daemons, daemons that aren't covered by the policy. And so this domain is unconfined as on purpose. Let's see if there's any signals, by the way. No, nothing new. This is mount on, this is old. Now, so it's unconfined. So NTPD listens on a port. But that port is currently... Oh, that's not, it's not found. But anyways, it's listening on port 123. And that port is undefined, so confined domains wouldn't be able to listen to that port, but this will be, this is able to do that. And here you have systemd tempt. Yeah, so basically these private temps are inside systemd tempt directory, so that's pretty neat as well. I suppose, although I wonder how that's. Going down. It's a bit messy this, because now basically I should probably change this. Yeah, I should change this. System D. So I'm basically saying here, allow system D to create temp with a type transition. But that's a bad idea because it's just using this for the private temp. So I should just allow system D to manage generic temp. So it's basically files manage generic tenders, and then just yeah, that var is fine. I'll leave that in there for var temp just in case, and then just call what is it, manage there's pattern, and then arc one. Oh, actually, yeah, arc one, tempty, tempty, and then disallow that because else stuff is going to break. Although this is nice. I should think about this carefully. You see, if you don't do this, now basically if you allow if you allow systemd to write manage generic temp dirs, then that's cool because it only uses it for private temp anyways, and then it'll be compatible whether you use private temp or not, so that makes it work automatically, unlike when you use the private type. So this is really the best way to go. So I'm going to remove this stuff here and files manage generic, and then DT, call that, and also another comment here, private temp, so just that you know, okay, that's for private temp there, and then remove that type altogether because we don't need it anymore. Okie dokie, and I don't have anything here. Is this still working? Shoot. No, it doesn't. Open parentheses in files. that's always the case. Files manage generic temp. 1, 2, 3. So just copy this over again. And I'll shut down because this type will become invalid. System control stop NPD, and then edit. Oops. Files again. Huge module. And then chain system D also, another huge module. I wanted to put the whole system D suite inside one module. I'm happy and glad I didn't do that, because even this is huge, and this is just system D and system control. Then there's like 55 other utilities. Paste that in. And then load policy. And then that temp directory becomes invalid here. That's on your left, you'll see it. That became invalid. But it was removed. Or was it? Yeah, it wasn't removed, so that was one. So now let's try that again. System control start NTPD. Starting a network time service. Meanwhile. Recent, we're clear. LSL C temp, and now you see that it's mounted in a generic temp directory, and you should get rid of these X11 stuffs in etc temp files period D directory. If there's a file in there that creates that by default, and you don't need that, but you can remove it, or it's user like temp files D somewhere there. So anyways, ps out, grab ntpd, it's an unconfined domain. So that'll make it so that the stuff just works. If you have a daemon that's covered by the policy, it just works. But you can also, if you basically remove the unconfined module, currently shit will hit the fan, because the session is basically totally dependent, the root shell session is totally dependent on unconfined. And so is the systemd daemon domain. But you could in theory create some confined domains for these two as well. But I really don't think I'm ever going to support that. An unconfined domain is just part of this policy. It's not optional, really. Although in practice you might be able to remove it, but then stuff functionality you will lose. But I'm just going to keep it. But I will probably, as for the root shell domain, I will probably make that a non-login user domain. So I will force login via confined domains. But I'm just probably going to do that with a boolean. And speaking of booleans, so this also allows you to label your booleans. This is all already possible with the old policy, but this one, sysfs, slinits, booleans. But since this one you have access to the raw policy files, you can actually edit the base. Back in the old days with the binary stuff, you had this base module and all these policy modules and stuff that was defined in the base module, like for example ports. You couldn't mess with that because you didn't have the source for those for that stuff on your system. And now in my implementation, I just have the source on the system. So if I want to basically add a port and label it right away, then I can just do that by editing the text file and running sclc. And same for boolean. If I want to basically add a boolean and I want to label it, then that's no problem. I can just do that. So that's why all the booleans here are labeled. These are all my booleans currently. Allow mount any file, console login, mmap low, and this stuff. This is currently all I have, and I should probably rename this allow mount any file. A lot of stuff I just copied from ref policy and from Fedora. I mean, why reinvent the wheel? There's some really nice ideas there. It's just that I'm a little bit tired of ref policy, but of the limitations of ref policy. And as for Fedora, yeah, it's just too general purpose. Same for reference policy, by the way. It's also too general purpose for my taste. I wanna basically have a very strict base and have it modifiable so that you have something to fall back on, and then you can just manually edit it. Because creating a policy module is like 5, maybe 10 minutes work, depends on. But your usual daemon is really easy to confine it. So what you need is a solid base that allows you to easily build on top of that, and then just leave the let the administrator fine-tune the services on the system, the apps and the user domains and stuff like that. Just make sure that your base is confined, that your kernel is confined, that your inner daemon is confined, and that your base system components like UDEV, SSH, that are always there, that those are confined in a way that work in every scenario. That's the most important thing for me. And that's why I'm doing this. It's basically just for my own taste, so to speak. So anyways, this works. So let's shut down once again and then do a console login, see if that works, and then shut down and do a single user mode login, and then that's basically concludes the demo. Again, of course, shut down, reboot now, have a good look at the console window, see if there's anything weird going on. It actually took a while, but it's actually rebooting. Like I said, it's not as trivial as it looks, this rebooting stuff. The fact that this works the way it works, without red and without fails, without journals being corrupted and all kinds of weird stuff, it's just pretty damn awesome. So root abc 123, and so here's this login the sec fault. Now this must be a not as Linux related, I suppose it could be, but I don't think it is. Are we clean? Yeah, we're clean. So we booted clean, we logged into console clean, and so you see that all that stuff is neatly confined. Getty, pocket, SSH, DHCPC, and LoginD, but login itself is also confined, and all the other core components are confined as well. So that's all nice and dandy. So let's just shut down. Let's just do another one. So shut down, reboot in 1 minute. And then PS aux and then fpaste. And then have a look at the list. And you see that there's another daemon in there. So we have journal, LVM metad, UDEV, network manager, system dbus, login, getTTI, pocket, SSH, DHCPC, and then login D. And then here we have shutdown. So this daemon basically starts when you say shut down everything, except now. If you shut down now, then the daemon is needed. But I'm saying shut down in the next minute, and then this daemon gets spawned, and it all makes sure that within a minute the system will be rebooted. And that's cool. And now I can basically boot into single user mode. So I'll just edit the grub and just add single in there and then see if that works. That was the last thing that failed, because, and I couldn't figure out, or well, I haven't thought about it very carefully, but turned out that sulogan didn't have the permissions required. And I was expecting ABC denials, but you shouldn't expect ABC denials because the most of, when there's early boot stuff, most of the time you don't see ABC denials. And there you go, single user mode. And it's all clean. And this is pretty pretty nice because I was able to shave off plenty permissions from Sudlogin. And so basically now you can, for example, control D, go to multi-user mode, but you could also do system control, reboot, stuff like that. So that basically concludes it. Everything is actually just confined except unspecified daemons, untargeted daemons, and the root shell session, which is currently the only session. And I'll probably add a boolean that toggles, that allows you to toggle roots or session logins or to off, so that you can restrict privileged logins. There's a lot of work to do, and that's one of the things. So that's it. Again, if you want to try it out, install a very small, minimal Fedora installation. Basically, basically install a guest or something like I did, and then install with text and no base. I'm not sure if Fedora still uses the no base kernel option, but at least use text and then install a minimal installation, and then you should probably just remove cron. And also probably if you're using in a guest, you probably want to use remove the QMU QA daemon, guest agent daemon, TA daemon. And then just basically install my packages, so you can basically just get the SSLC spec file from this repository here. Then inside that spec file is the link to where you can get the source file. You can basically just, I'll just show you that. SSLC, where are you? Basically here, this link here, you can use this to get source. So you can just do wget and then this link, and then replace the short commit with the short commit with this, which is the first seven digits here. So it's like something like this here. So you can just use that for the short commit, replace it with short commit, and then do wget and get it. And then you can use the spec file to RPM build all and create this file. It'll install, if you install this RPM, it'll basically compile SSLC and put it into a user bin SSLC here, and install the license, and that's it, really clean. It doesn't have much dependencies at all, only some build requires. But I don't think it has actually any other requirements, because it's using static SE policy library. So and then you don't actually have to do anything with policy query tails. You could use my policy query tails, same procedure, but you can also just use Fedora's policy query tails. And then for monogam spec, basically same drill here. You have the link. Can just replace the commit with the commit here, and then wget it. I did it myself in the beginning of this exercise, and then just build this, and then just install it. Just remember that with this policy, don't use RPM in enforcing mode, because that won't work, and that's something I'm going to fix. I'm going to deal with soon. But oh yeah, there's just one other thing that I haven't shown, which is the way that is also not going to work for you until you get a updated systemd package. So basically, we now have this these user runtime directories in /run /user/user, and then all this the root. So you have these, the run user, yeah, it's basically a runtime directory where basically you, kind of the same as slash home, where users have their own directories for runtime content. But basically, there's no real neat way to handle this without a patch for systemd, which allows you to define the context and policies when systemd creates this directory. Logind creates this on behalf of the user. That logind creates that with a proper context, and my load policy shell script basically handles the file context for this location. But if systemd does not restore it, then your run directories become mislabeled. Now that's not a problem because it's currently it's not used anyways, so In a text-based system, you won't have a problem with that because nothing is using it. Yeah, systemd is trying to traverse runtime, so that'll fail. But there's nothing in there. So if you look in this run user 0 there, you'll see that there's just nothing in there. So nothing is using it. But in graphical user environments, this is heavily used by desktop apps that need to create some stateless stuff there. It's on a tempfs directory, so it's all temporary stuff. But anyway, so just keep that in mind that to get this work to work, this run root, this run user stuff, you need a patch to systemd, and hopefully that will be submitted anytime soon now. It takes a little while for such a simple one-liner. But I'm just saying. Okay, so that's basically, so you install it, make sure that RPM is in permissive mode, when you install it that's in permissive mode, and then go switch to enforcer mode and then test it out. Make sure that you just realize that it's for a minimal system, Fedora 20, it's designed for Fedora 20, but it would be nice if others could get this to work on Debian, hopefully then Debian with systemd, because you this policy, I wouldn't want to mess with old init daemons and stuff like that. But so yeah, that's basically it.